Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome here to the funeral services for John Floyd Johnson. I'm Jeff Hoyer. I'm conducting the service here. And a family prayer was given by Jace Poole. And prelude music here by Lucille Hoyer, who will also be playing with Eden Hoyer conducting. And we'd like to recognize that Bishop Oakes is presiding here at this funeral with Bishop Moe, close family member also attending and on the stand as well. We'd like to open by singing the opening hymn, Families Can Be Together Forever. And the words are printed on the back of the program. Read John's life sketch, and then Robin Hoyer and Deborah Poole will offer life memories that all of the children and grandchildren have contributed. John Floyd Johnson was born in Bella, California on December 5th, 1940. His parents were John Marvin Johnson, Blanche, and Blanche Velma Snyder. He had two younger brothers, David Bruce, who preceded him in death, and Eric Allen. He grew up in Los Angeles, California, where his father owned a company called Talbot Manufacturing. He attended school in Los Angeles until they moved to Whittier when he was a teen. John was a greaser during high school, but he grew up to be the first police officer for the city of La Habra, and then a California highway patrolman for over 30 years. John married Patricia Rosa Clark in 1960 and had two daughters, Robin Cecilia and Deborah Michelle. After he retired, they moved to Utah to be closer to their grandchildren. John left us on the 18th of December, 2020 due to complications of sepsis. He is survived by his wife of just over 60 years, 10 grandchildren and their spouses, and 18 great-grandchildren. And so next we're gonna have the memories of Papa that I'd just like to start by offering you. One of my own. When Robin and I were first married, We first went down to their house, this was our honeymoon. We did a frantic trip down there after having a reception here, and then we were going to be having a reception down there. It was a combined reception for Robin and Deborah, who got married on the same weekend. It must have been a good weekend because we're all still together. But I remember I went into their house and we were all standing there talking, and I reached and I put my arms around Robin from behind just to hug her. And the look that came over John's face was like, somebody's touching my daughter. Over the years, he got used to the idea of me touching her. But John and I were not afraid to say, I love you to each other, and we did often. And I am so glad, because that's the thing that we said, and the last thing that I said to him just now, I love you, John.
And so I said hi to him as we walked by, and he said hi to me. And he asked me my name, and we started talking a little bit. Mom said something to the effect of, we have to go. And the guy said, just leave him with me. I'm going to be here for about 30 minutes if you want to go do your shopping. I don't mind talking. And Mom said, okay. It was a different time. She left me with a highway patrolman whose name I have never known. And we talked the whole time. I don't know about what, other than he asked me questions and I asked him questions. When she came back, she said it was time to go. And he said, yeah, I gotta go back to work anyway. And we started to walk away. I said goodbye to him and he shook hands. And walking away, he said, hey, Johnny, when you grow up, be a highway patrolman. You'd make a good one. And from that day on, I knew what I was going to do.
Okay, so I never knew that story about him, so it's kind of nice to find out something new every day about Dad. This is a memory of Brittany's, but it coincides with one of my earliest memories of my dad. Brittany said, being excited to have someone to watch cartoons with in the morning. And one of my earliest memories of Dad is he would always lay down on the floor and lean on his arm, and Robin and I would lean up against him like a couch, and we were on the floor and we'd watch TV. And it didn't have to be cartoons, but cartoons were always the best. But it was everything. I can remember watching Walt Disney World.
Romper Room, because the girl was cute.
Yeah, that's right, the Romper Room, because the girl was cute. But then he got into the motorcycle accident when he was on the job, and that put an end to us laying on the floor together, but he never stopped watching cartoons with us.
So when Dad was 13, he is a big kid. He's a big guy still, and he was a big kid, and he and his best friend went and enlisted in the Navy. They were 13. The enlistment guy didn't realize they were 13. When they didn't show up to their enlistment date, the MPs called my grandma and said, we're looking for John Johnson. And she said, why? And they told her, and she said, you can't have him. He's in school. He's only 13.
This one is from Shada. Some of the most frequent and earliest memories of Papa are of him being up at the crack of dawn. Whether we were visiting them or they were at our house, I always knew Papa would be up when I got up in the morning.
Dad and Mom met early and they married when they were only 17 and 19, and Dad turned 20 2 days later, but they got married in 60, sorry. I'm thinking, when did Disneyland open? Because I didn't write it down. But they would often go to Disneyland, but before he took Mom to Disneyland, he took some other girl. And a lot of our memories with him are about Disneyland because we always went. The Anaheim, the Highway Patrol agreed to direct traffic for the opening of Disneyland when the Anaheim police wouldn't do it. And so Walt made sure that the Highway Patrol had free tickets, so we could go anytime we wanted to, which explains my obsession. But Dad took another girl when it very first opened, and he spun it, the teacup, so hard and so fast, and he never looked up. The girl's head flopped back, and all the blood vessels in her eyes burst. And when I was a little kid, I can remember how fast that the teacups would spin. I don't think they can spin that fast now.
I think they are.
Don't you have a Disneyland memory from Uncle Rick?
No, you didn't.
Oh, I do.
Sorry.
Where's Uncle Rick's? Well, you can tell me while I find Uncle Rick's.
Okay. I'm just going to relate a memory for Jace that I remember. When we got married in the temple, you know, everybody were waiting to go back and stuff, and I guess Dad sat down with Jace in the temple and told him, "Now don't worry, she'll settle down in a couple of years." Little did Dad know. So.
My Uncle Rick is my dad's younger brother, who is 8 years younger than he is. And he sent me some memories. He says, "One of my favorite memories of my brother John is him taking me to Disneyland. It was my first trip there the year they had their grand opening. There were so many firsts with him. After we retired, we went on our first RV trip with him and Patty. We still have lots of memories of our travels to Canada. I was very proud to call him my big brother, and he is the reason I went into law enforcement. The middle brother, David, also was in law enforcement. One of our passions was riding trains, which we did in every state we visited. We rode the tracks in Utah on many occasions, including this past October. He never knew a stranger on the trains, always talking to people. He always introduced me as his baby brother, no matter how old I was, 71. He was just as proud of me as I was of him. Our uncle had surgery and was unable to be here, and we're hoping he's watching on the Zoom."
While we're on Disneyland, so Dad was always my hero, and a lot of my stories revolve around that. But when we were growing up, we went to Disneyland a lot. But Mom, and you know your mom, she got that same gene about not being able to ride the crazy rides. But me and Dad were, I always wanted to ride the wild rides and everything. But when I was 10, the school, I don't know about the schools down here, and I know that our school did kind of a science camp in fifth grade, and you got to go overnight for a week or something. Pretty sure I didn't let my kids do that, but anyway. I was supposed to be able to go to that, but something happened and I wasn't able to. So instead, Dad was my hero, and he took me to Disneyland, just me and him, and we rode all of the big roller coasters and everything. And that was one of my favorite memories growing up.
Did you ride the teacups?
Yeah, we did.
So Paul Johnson is my father's first cousin, and they're only 6 months apart in age. He lives somewhere up in Idaho.
Rigby.
And he sent me two different memories. The first one, he says, "I call it the country boy teaches the city boy how to drive a tractor. Someone was there with an 8mm camera as John used up about 20 acres trying to get the old Ford 8N tractor to go where he wanted. I was on the hood, hanging on for dear life. And the second one is, several times during our younger teenage years, John's family would venture out of California and spend some time at the turkey farm in Arizona. I can't remember how it came about, but John and I, and perhaps David, decided Rick needed to be baptized in the horse's water trough. Quite a battle, as I recall.
So this one is actually a combo of Brittany and Jordan. Brittany said she remembers going to the toy store, every toy store, to look for police cars. And Jordan's memories is, Papa had a collection of model police cars. I thought they were very cool, and I wanted some like him. He used to buy me police car replicas from different states. I kept them all in a drawer in my room and got so excited when he would bring me a new one. Those cars meant a lot to me.
Dad was a car guy, as you all know, and one of the things he talked about in our interview was how he ended up buying a 1967 Mustang. He had to give a guy a ride and he ended up at a car lot. And this is what he said. We pull into the place and here sat this yellow Mustang fastback, and I said, boy, I found out the Mustang was for sale. I think it was something like $1,500, which was quite a bit of money in those days. But I said, can I take it over to show my wife? And they said, go ahead. I drove it over to where your mom worked and said, let's have a Mustang. And she agreed. I was really surprised.
I'm sorry, I'm not as organized as Robin. So this one is also from Shyla. I remember his big hugs, feeling his mustache tickling my cheek, and him, she changed the word and I didn't change it.
Grumbling,
that's right. Like I was squishing him when we hugged. I remember him doing that for me too.
So, Mom and Dad, when they were dating, would go to the drive-in. And I was like, yeah, I'll just bet you went to the drive-in. He says, no, we went to the movie. Your mother said, if you want to nap, we can stay home and do that. So we watched the movie. Many of my memories are going to the drive-in because they would pop a big bag, a brown paper bag full of popcorn, and we'd go. And it was always a double feature, and I think Debbie and I would sleep in the back and they would watch the movies. Dad said also, he told me a story I kind of think I remember, but I'm not sure. He said, I drove off with one of the speakers one night because you would roll your window down and hang the speaker inside the car. And it had a wire for all of my children who have never been to a drive-in movie. It had a wire that went to the post, and that's how they got all the sound to the various cars. And he said, he drove off with one of the speakers because we'd take the speaker and pull it through the driver's window and drop it on the floor and turn it all the way up because you got better sound that way. One night we were leaving the drive-in and I forgot to put it back, and as I drove off it shot right in front of me and hit the window of the car. It didn't break the window, but it pulled the wiring out, and I looked at that and said, I am not going back. It went home with us.
When I was in high school, I was on the varsity tennis team, and I figured that I'd never have anybody at my matches because Mom worked full time, and of course the games were always after school and stuff. But I soon found out that no matter where Dad was, he would find a way to come to my matches in uniform. And so I always appreciated him doing that.
Before I get into what my children remembered, and that's all I have from Dad, but I have 14 other pages of it at home, so anybody who wants it, email me. My very favorite memory of my dad is I was 16 years old, and I was always late coming to through my curfew. So I was in trouble with my mom. Dad was at work. He worked nights a lot. And he could come home and have lunch or whatever. And he happened to come home. I don't know if mom called him or what. And I just had this huge fight and been grounded forever by my mother. And I was sad. And Dad came home and we talked. And he always had the TV on. And we had the TV on, and it was after midnight on Saturday night. And he looks at the TV, and we see this newscaster for the news break picking his nose. I'm like, what? And my dad looks at me and says, what the heck happens to NBC after midnight? And that was the first time any of us knew anything about Saturday Night Live, because we had no idea. Chevy Chase just looked so, he sounded like a newscaster. But then he started picking his nose, and we're like, what is going on the TV? I will read Matt's. Matt is my oldest. I don't have a single special memory to share with Papa, so here's some random little ones. I'll always remember how whenever I called him, he would pick up with, hello, Matthew. How he constantly broke every single one of his electronics, which I suspect was an excuse to get me to come and visit so I could fix them. Or when I lobbied to get a Ford Mustang for my 16th birthday. Matt has the car gene, in case you were wondering. Still the only Mustang I've ever owned. I was unamused by it, as I recall. Recently, we bonded over my interest in firearms, and I think he was happy to have someone around to talk to about them. I'll miss him more than I can express.
Let's back up, because you missed the part where...
Oh, we gave him a Hot Wheels Mustang. I missed that. So, Papa gave him a Hot Wheels Mustang for his 16th birthday, and Matt was unamused. Sorry.
Okay, now this is a funny one, and I'm going to paraphrase it some for Brittany. There was a summer that Mom and Dad came up with their fifth wheel and stayed the summer in their fifth wheel so that they could go to all the rodeos and stuff. And Papa had all of his car modeling stuff in Brittany's basement, so he had a key to the house. And apparently, Jason and I had gone somewhere, I don't know if it was the weekend or the middle of the week or what, but Dad was staying at our house with Jordan so that he had some supervision. And late one night, Dad came busting into Brittany's house yelling, don't shoot, it's Papa, I can't find Jordan. And Brittany said, you know, as they were sleeping, she is dragging the bed out with her to cover herself because she wasn't, you know, appropriately dressed. And so she's like, and he's like, I called everywhere, you know, I called him and he's not answering. And so Brittany went ahead and called Jordan, and I guess the first thing she heard was, I fell asleep. And so he was at his friend's house and they had fallen asleep, and lo and behold, he was an hour late and Grandpa couldn't find him. Well, I didn't find out about this story until a number of years later, because Papa said, we don't need to tell your mother about this.
I want to know all those secrets. Christopher says, when I got home from my mission, I wanted to get married but had no money for a ring. Papa offered to buy it for me and let me pay it off by helping him finish his basement. I spent many Saturdays working on it with him, and I am very grateful for those hours I spent with him. His wife, Ginger, who didn't have grandparents when she was growing up. She had them, but her grandfathers died before she was born, and her grandma, she didn't see them very often. So my parents were her grandparents, and my son knew her before his mission. And she said, they took me in and got to know me and told me that they would be my grandparents. Near the end of my husband's mission, they even told me that if he came home and he decided that he didn't want to marry me, that they would keep me anyway. My husband came home and paid Papa back for my engagement ring. And then James is 11 and he has autism and he's always been kind of fun. Ginger says, when my son was young, he was very hard to take care of. He cried often and was hard to calm down. It set everybody's teeth on edge. But then Papa would come over and he would take James out of my arms and they would go outside and sit on the front porch and talk about the cars driving by. It worked every time. So.
Shyla says, he was a great storyteller. He could remember details and just enough embellishment to keep you hooked. But Shelley, you do know that he probably made up most of it.
You know.
I gave him a shirt. What did it say? It said, "Papa, what I don't know, I make up."
Yeah. Wait, I have to say, I always said that I grew up with a warped sense of history because what Dad didn't know, he made up on the spot.
Like driving along and seeing the guys eating, the train guys sitting on the tracks. And my mom says, "What's that? Why are they doing that?" And he said, "Well, they need a lunch break."
Or
he didn't know.
Or in Idaho, there's a big statue of an Indian on a corner. And I think Mom said, "I wonder what that statue is." And my father said, "Oh, that's Chief Idaho." And this was when we were engaged. And I said, "Oh, Jace doesn't know that. I'm going to have to tell him." Dad didn't know that either.
So Jace, it's not Big Chief Idaho where we were. Robert is my son-in-law, married to our only daughter, and he's allergic to cantaloupe, which we all know. But one family dinner, I accidentally cut up the watermelon with the knife used to cut the cantaloupe. And so he started to swell up, and my dad took him to the store because we had no Benadryl in our house. Robert said, "The conversation we had on the drive to the store back reminded me of the many drives I had taken with my own grandfather. I will forever cherish that memory. Though Papa's actions were simple, they left a profound impression of what a grandfather should be. Concerned, selfless, and quick to act." And then my daughter tells that her favorite memory of her grandpa is him telling his favorite memory of her. And she says, "When I was 3 years old, Papa was coming to visit. I don't remember why, but it was near my birthday. He was bringing me a pink Barbie doll, and apparently I was very much looking forward to receiving that Barbie doll. When he pulled up in the driveway and got out of the car, I came bursting out of the house, running towards him, all excited. Papa, Papa, Papa. He thought I was excited to see him. Instead, about 2 feet in front of him, I put on the brakes, slammed my hands on my hips, stared him down, and demanded, 'Where is my pink Barbie?'" I remember him telling that story. Papa got such enjoyment out of retelling that story, he told it to me at least every couple of months my entire life. He would always smile and laugh when he told it. He got such enjoyment out of remembering me as a 3-year-old brat. I told him, at least I knew what I wanted and wasn't afraid to ask for it. I still have that pink Barbie in my box of childhood toys. She was well loved and is quite the mess, but I will always keep her."
Brittany says, "Mostly though, it's all the little things that made him Papa. His laugh, his hangry, which many of my grandchildren and I have. Gad, big warm hugs and whiskery kisses. Bribing the babes with food, his spaghetti, breakfast whenever we visited, and just feeling safe, comforted, and loved whenever he was around."
My son Daniel, his daughter Aria is 4, and she went through a phase where she was afraid of my dad. And then Daniel grew a beard, because my dad had a big beard at the time. He always has had that big mustache. In fact, I remember one time in my life, maybe, that he shaved it off. He's always had it. But she was afraid of it. So Daniel grew a beard, and then she wasn't afraid of Papa anymore. Papa always told them about how happy he was that she wasn't afraid of him. And then Daniel says, "When I was having issues with my legs, Papa loaned me his cane. We would joke about how convenient it was to carry a cane because people would get out of your way. And even if you walked into someone, they would apologize to you like it was their fault." He also talks about how he could spend hours sitting in my dad's project room where he built his dioramas and model cars. He loved to explain the fine details of the processes he used to make things look old and weathered, and I loved listening and learning about it. I'm glad that the last few years I found an interest in World War II and other historical happenings. Papa and I would talk about stuff I was learning, and he'd recommend books he liked, and it was something we really connected over. I'm sure going to miss him. And then his wife, Melody, talked about how He always accepted her as a granddaughter, and it didn't matter to him that she was a family by marriage rather than by blood. It's been such a blessing to be part of not only Daniel's immediate family, but to be adopted and loved by all of his grandparents as well. I love how much he's loved my kids. Initially, Aria was apprehensive around him until we started sneaking him Smarties so he could bribe her with them. Though I think the true turning point was when Daniel grew a beard. After winning her over, he'd tell us every time we saw him how happy he was that she was excited to see him. It was a joy to watch them interact. And from Aria, who is 4, when asked, "What do you love about Papa?" "He gives me Smarties."
I'm probably not going to get this right because I just barely heard this morning, and it's from my daughter-in-law, Jen. I think it was our granddaughter Hazel's birthday. And she was opening presents. Did she open a pair of handcuffs?
No, he just brought it up.
Oh, okay. But right in the middle of this birthday party, Papa pointed at Jordan and Jen, who were newly married, and said, "Was it you two that wanted my handcuffs?"
No comment. So we had 4 children, 5.5 years, and then 3 more children. The oldest of my youngest is named Jacob, and he was about 3 when they moved to Highland, 3 houses down from us. And he said he remembers this giant moving truck, and he swears that Papa let him ride in it with him. I don't know if he did, but I'm glad that's what he remembers. And he says, "Papa taught me how to fish when I was pretty young, I think around 5. We went several times and it was always fun. At one point, Papa was teaching me how to cast by sticking me in the front yard and having me try to cast my line across the street into the neighbor's yard. At the time, the road was a dead end, so you didn't have to worry about it, the traffic. I have a lot of other memories, like Papa teaching me how to power wash the trailer, which was actually really fun, letting me shoot the BB gun in the backyard and showing me his models, explaining the small details that went into them. But the biggest thing I will remember about Papa is that he was my friend. And his wife, Eden, has been with us almost 3 years, 2.5. I'm going to read hers because I don't think I could tell this story. Jake and I had gone over to Grandma and Papa's house to visit. They had sat down in their chairs, which are pretty close together, and we had sat down across their family room. We were just talking casually about life. Then we said something to Papa, and he had some trouble hearing. So he said, "I'm sorry, what?" And Grandma commented, good-humoredly, something to the effect of, "Always deaf as a post, don't worry." Then we said something to Grandma, and she said, "I'm sorry, what?" And Papa said something to almost identical to Grandma's comment of, "Oh, she's deaf as a post, don't worry." And then they turned to each other and hadn't been able to hear the other's comments, so they both said, "What?" We were rolling. It was hilarious. It was a classic example of people who had been together forever, and although they were humorously not able to hear each other, they put forth the effort to make sure they were understood. There was just so much love in their relationship.
Okay. And I'm going to read this. This, too, is from Shyla. "I'm not the best at remembering specific memories, but I do remember feelings. Again, it seems like all my kids make me cry. And I knew Papa was proud of me and loved me, whether it was rodeo, my kids, or me just being me. I knew he was proud and willing to tell whoever would listen." And that's true. I've been with Dad numerous times when he would brag to total strangers about my kids. And I always appreciated that.
Mom and Dad moved up when Ben was 2, I think. So Benjamin sends me this memory. I have a couple of specific memories that I thought of, but I'm sure that someone has taken them already. I will say that I always liked the way he greeted us. He had a specific way of pronouncing each of our names with specific inflection. I had it in my head a minute ago.
Benjamin.
No one has ever said my name like he did, and I won't be hearing it again for a little while. He cared about each of us, and I will miss him. And he is engaged to Callista, And Calista says, "I went to their house for the first time and he brought me down to the basement to show me his car collection, and he looked ecstatic when he was explaining and answering questions on how he built the buildings and most of his hobbies, models. It was nice seeing what he did for a hobby."
And then this one is about Jordan. We had four wheelers and we'd gotten a second one, I think it was, and mom and dad were up and dad wanted to ride one of the four wheelers. And so Jordan went with him and went across the road with him. And when he got back, Jordan told me, he says, "Wow, Papa can really ride a four wheeler. He says, I think he's better than me."
So I asked him in that interview, about to tell me about their wedding, and this is a direct quote. This is what he said. Oh, wait till you see. There we go. He said, "Listen, are you ready?" He said, "We got married." That was it. "Tell me about your wedding." "We got married." So he was not Catholic, and my mother was Catholic. This is a little bit of a long story. And so he had to take lessons, like catechism. And they did that with the priest. And the priest told them they wouldn't be able to be married on the altar because he was not a member, and he was never baptized. But then a different priest heard about it, and he said, "Oh, you can." They were friends. And he said, "You can be married on the altar." So they were married in the Catholic Church. It's called St. Gregory's in Whittier, California. And when we say our parents did everything with us, they were there no matter what we did. They were there. They got involved in it. They were the parental support for the entire organization of whatever we were doing. I have high school friends who even today say, "I remember high school and your parents," because they were always there. So I don't know why, but I was afraid to tell my parents when I was a senior in high school that I was investigating the church. And so I hid my stuff, not very well apparently, because my dad saw it one time and said, was it dad that said it? "We have a budding Mormon in the house," and my mom said, "Oh no, she reads everything." But I was investigating the church. I had my missionary discussions at the bishop's house because I didn't want to have them at my house. And my parents, I told them when it was time to get baptized, my parents said, or the missionaries said, "You have to tell your parents." And I'm like, "I don't want to tell my parents." "No, no, you have to tell your parents." Even though I was a freshman in college, I said, "Fine, I'll tell my parents." So I told my parents, and they came to my baptism. They took me out for dinner afterwards. And in the car on the way to dinner, they argued about who they would rather talk to about our church, the cute little missionaries, my mother, or the member of the 70, he was probably the word missionary equivalent today, who was older. My dad wanted to talk to him. But he was appalled that these boys went out and supported themselves for 2 years. And of course he was worried about what they ate, so he said, "You need to invite those boys over for dinner." And so I told the missionaries they could come for dinner, but they couldn't. Oh, and he said, "But I don't want to talk to them about their religious stuff." I'm like, okay. So they came to dinner a number of times, what, 6, 8 times, before my dad said, "Well, maybe next time you come, you can tell me a little bit about your religion." And I was baptized in January of 1980, and my parents were, and my sister, were baptized in June of 1980. They did everything we did.
I'm gonna go back to, so Robin's best friend in high school was Yvonne, and I think it was your freshman year, is that when you met? And the first time that she brought Yvonne home with her, and you gotta remember, Grandpa would have been, so Robin was 14, so he was 34. Yeah. Alex and Devin and Brittany, you know, so right your age, you know, Matthew. And so she brought Yvonne home, and they walked through the family room where Dad was sitting, and into the bedroom where I was, and Yvonne grabbed Robin and said, "Why didn't you tell me you had a gorgeous older brother?" And she was like, "Ew, that's my dad."
I have a couple of really quick ones, and then I have one from Caleb that I'll end up with. As far as doing everything we did, we had a pool. We lived in Whittier from the time I was 12 until I was 18, and we had a pool. And all of my friends, it was like the place to be. And we had this really rough game we played with the ball. Do you remember that game? I can't remember what we called it. But it was rough, and it was loud, and it was practically every night. And my parents, we had a tiki hut thing that was in the corner of the yard. The whole backyard was just this pool. It was all concrete and this little hut in the corner. And my parents would sit out there and watch us play this game over and over and over. I don't know how they did it. My dad would read. Mom, I assume she would read or stay in the house. I think he mostly did the lecturing. Dad really cared about how he looked. And one time when we were camping for a family reunion with his cousins, he was somewhere and he was doing his hair with hairspray, and I walked in and he said, "Close the door." And I said, "Why?" And he said, "I don't want them to know that I use hairspray." Oh, and Debbie and I used to fight. So Dad was a cop, and he often worked nights, and he was always, almost often home when we were in the afternoons, and we had to wake him up when we got home from school. And we would have the worst fights about who had to wake Dad up, because he would wake up, he was scary, like you would touch him and then he would jump away, because he came out swinging from when he was sleeping.
Literally.
And I don't think he did that after he retired. I think he would, but that was some of our worst fights were over who had to wake Dad up. And then finally, my last thing is from Caleb. He's our youngest, he is 20. And he says, "My favorite memory of Papa was when I was very young. I was just getting old enough to start remembering things, and it was my first time eating a hamburger that wasn't cut into convenient chunks. Because of this, I wanted it to be the perfect hamburger. Grandma was the one making the burger, and I kept finding things wrong with it that I wanted her to fix. I can't remember how many times she had to remake it. It was at least 2 times, probably more. But she was getting tired of my antics. The burger was finally perfect, according to a little kid's sense of the word. But there was one more problem. It was far too tall to fit in my mouth. When I started complaining about it, Papa reached over and flattened the burger with his hand. I bet you didn't know my dad invented the smash burger. It went from being 2 or 3 inches high to less than an inch high. I just sat there staring at the burger and eventually picked it up and ate it. Everyone else was probably keeled over with laughter at that point. I think my mom said that she and Benjamin were like, they couldn't even eat, they were laughing so hard. To this day, every time I eat a hamburger, I put my hand on it and smash it a bit. It's become something of a ritual for me, and now it is something that I can do to keep myself connected to my papa. I will miss him dearly, and I hope he has plenty of hamburgers to smash in heaven."
Okay, so one last one for me. Like I said, the hero. So Robin and I were in bands, and she was in the band, I was in the color guard for Cavaliers, and I don't know if we were in regiment for this one, but we had gone to Jack in the Box, and we were in uniform with a couple of other people, and it was hot, it was summer, and we'd gotten our meal and got back in the car with our friends, and we were driving down the road. Well, apparently there were some guys behind us that had followed us. And since we had the windows down, You know, some guys are just jerks, but anyway, they threw a chocolate shake through the window and it got all over like our white shirts and our boots and everything. And we took down their license plate number and went home and gave it to my dad. And he looked up their address and name and everything, and unfortunately it wasn't in his jurisdiction, but he had a sheriff friend whose jurisdiction it was in. And so he gave the number and everything to this friend, and the friend went to the house and asked for the kid who was driving and asked him how he liked chocolate shakes. So, and then after that, anytime that car went anywhere, you know it was harassed by the police officers because, you know, mess with my daughter, you mess with me. So, and I have lots more stories like that about Dad, but we're running short of time.
I think one way we could sum that up is that Papa loved his family, and he loved them fiercely, and his life was all about his family. We're now going to have a musical selection. Now, this is something that Papa told my daughter Tamala earlier this year. He said, hey, I have a couple things I want to have happen at my funeral, and I know you'll remember these. So he told her, and one of them was that he wanted to have the song played Through the Years by Kenny Rogers. And he said, I know it's going to be, Pat never will cry, but it's the perfect song because it describes my marriage and my relationship with my beloved wife. So we're going to have that now. And then we'll have some remarks here by Bishop Oaks. And after his remarks, we'll have the closing hymn, I Am a Child of God. And then Devin Bateman will give us our benediction.
I've always been so I've never followed Kenny Rogers before. But that was wonderful, a wonderful song, and what a wonderful tribute this has been to a wonderful man, John Floyd Johnson. Thank you, Pat, for allowing me the privilege of being a part of this today. When the boundaries changed in our ward a few years ago, about 8 or 9 years ago, John and Patricia became members of our ward. I remember the first time I got to hear John Johnson speak. I wanted to listen. When he would bear his testimony, I wanted to listen. When he taught priestly, I wanted to listen. When my counselor, Brother Richens, and I, after we became a bishop about 2 years ago, we came to visit John and Pat at their home. John took us downstairs, as I think everyone that ever visited your home was taken downstairs. And he would show them not only his car collection, but all these beautiful miniature dioramas that he had created. And when he, I think my favorite was the old service station. And when he told me how he made them, the materials that he would use and things like that, I listened. Because of COVID, most of my visits this year have been by telephone. But just 2 weeks ago, can you believe that? I was able to come and visit with John and Pat in their home. And I listened. I listened as John told me that he was a full tithe payer. He wanted me to know that. And here's the important part. He said, when my wife Pat and I joined the church, we made a commitment that we would pay our tithe. And we always have. The next thing he told me was that his temple recommend was about to expire at the end of December, and he wanted to renew it. Unfortunately, he went to the hospital before we could make those arrangements. But John left this life with a current temple recommend. In this life, John kept his covenants with the Lord. Doctrine and Covenants, section 97, verse 8 says, "Verily I say unto you, all among them who know their hearts are honest, and are broken, and their spirits contrite, and are willing to observe their covenants by sacrifice, yea, every sacrifice which I the Lord shall command, they are accepted of me." Although John did not want to leave this earth just yet, he had things that he wanted to do, but he was ready. He showed us how to be accepted of the Lord. He has been faithful over a few things, and now can be made ruler over many things, and can now enter into the joy of the Lord. John showed us how to lead this life. He showed us how to end each day by keeping our covenants. May the Lord help each of us as we try to be true and faithful to all the Lord asks of us. Is my prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we thank for today, for the opportunity to come and listen to all these wonderful stories about John, and for all the hearts that he was able to touch, and all the people he was able to guide in his life, and for the wonderful daughters he raised, and everything that he's done for them. We thank for all of the guidance that he gave me in my life and everything, and I'm grateful for that. Please bless those this day that are here today and from the way that they can be watched over and they can be comforted in this time. And we say thank you to John for everything he's done for every one of us. And please bless and watch over everyone and say, travel home, they can have a homeland safety and say, see you soon, Chris.
So John will be interred here at the Highland City Cemetery next door, and that will follow here immediately. And the dedicatory prayer there will be given by Alex Heimer. Thank you all for coming today.